Hello. Okay, hi everybody, good morning. I am Shamik Mishra from Arisent, and I would be presenting today some thoughts about NFV orchestration and the challenges we faced recently in telecom deployments. I'm quite new to OpenStack, and this is my first OpenStack summit, and I had actually listed a lot of challenges, and some of the challenges actually got solved during the summit itself. So I found there are solutions already existing. So some of the problems that I might state, you might have already heard about it in the summit, but nevertheless, let's go ahead with it. So my main focus area is management and network orchestration of network function virtualized elements. And currently, I am working in identifying the requirements for NFV mono architecture, and then also trying to specify an extensible and a modular architecture for the NFV service orchestrator. And in the process, also trying to define what possibly we need to change in the underlying virtual infrastructure manager. In our case, it's OpenStack. So this is mostly my focus area. And today we would be covering some of these things. So some implementation challenges, and what are those challenges that we are facing currently, and we'll go deep into one of the challenges, that is end-to-end service monitoring of NFV, and how this end-to-end service monitoring of NFV is also related to the eventual orchestration of the NFV elements. And I will introduce a model which we call a service creation model, and then we'll discuss a bit about a service-aware monitoring system and how we can link the monitoring system with the KPI, with the orchestrator and the orchestration, the overall orchestration of the system. Finally, I will speak a bit about a certain proof of concept that we did for wireless cloud RAN use case. And we will look into how we deployed this and orchestrated this on OpenStack, and then what were the results and what were the challenges that we faced with cloud RAN. Then if we have time, then there are certain things that we think community needs to come forward and perhaps support to get a very efficient orchestration system for NFV done. What could be that particular community communities of contribution is something we can look at it. Okay, so a quick recap of network function virtualization. It's a ETSI mandated standard. And here in traditional systems, we have several separate network elements like routers, firewalls, the packet gateway, the LTE packet core network, the load balancers, the applications, the distribution switch, the IMSs, all are running on dedicated hardware as a separate appliance. Most of these functions, since they are running on dedicated hardware, a lot of unused computing capability is there, because these hardwares are not exactly designed for optimal usage. It is designed for peak capacity, and there is not always a peak capacity at any point of time. So there could be a certain time when we have a peak capacity. For the rest of the time, the hardware and the computing capabilities of this of these elements are often wasted. And all of them have separate management systems, and more importantly, separate ways of monitoring them. And it is also very difficult to introduce services rapidly. And from there, towards NFV, we are trying to host all of these applications and commodity hardware through virtualization. We use the specifics of cloud, for example, scalability, elasticity, and the efficient usage of resources which cloud brings in order to have a more efficient, more dynamic, more flexible, more scalable NFV deployments. It's, of course, cost effective. But however, this is just the tip of the iceberg. There are a lot of challenges which go with it. I'm not sure whether you are able to read all of this, but we took a survey from the heavy reading from different NFV clients. This survey was done around in 2014, and we realized that there are several impediments towards commercializing NFV, and some of them are like the reliability of Quartz hardware, and also perhaps the most important thing that we are going to discuss today is how to troubleshoot and service assure and assure the service delivery of the NFV components. So we would be discussing these two items, that is the cloud orchestration part and troubleshooting part, in with very specific area of troubleshooting and service assurance, not the entire cloud architecture as such, but more focused on the applications that are going to get hosted on OpenStack. So eventually, network function virtualization is not just bringing your the legacy software to the cloud. So it is much beyond that. And more importantly, perhaps the biggest impediment is how to ensure the SLAs that an operator agrees, and how that SLA is actually enforced downwards on the cloud infrastructure and in conjunction with the virtual network functions. A very high-level challenge, and we'll go into depth in one of them, so is actually how to realize large-scale NFV deployments. For example, you might have hundreds of service chains. There are several functions which are hosted on the cloud. How to monitor them, how to replicate them, for example, if a new tenant comes, how quickly can we replicate? For example, if we have optimized a network for one of the tenants, can we like use that for subsequent deployments? Can we replicate a complete working deployment from one cloud to another? So these are one of the few, I would say, one of the many challenges that we have in NFV. Also, how to simplify it. We are eventually moving towards NFV because we want to simplify the service delivery and automate the service delivery. So if we do not simplify the overall network architecture, then most probably we'll end up with similar problems that we have in the legacy side as well. And the overall network, the end-to-end network, need not entirely be virtualized. There could be certain components which might run on the customer premises. It can actually be a legacy hardware. And so if we are planning to optimize one part of the network, then we cannot just ignore the legacy side as well. So if we have to optimize, if we have to make certain automated decisions, we have to do it for the entire network, not just the ones which are hosted on cloud. Also, the dependencies of telecom applications are such that each of them have a very strong dependency with each other when they're chained. So if we scale up one of the elements in the chain, then most probably we need to touch or modify the other elements, the neighboring elements of that particular scaled element. So overall, there seems to be a situation where we need to take a lot of decisions on how to optimize the system, how to replicate the system, how to create larger networks, how to simplify the architecture, how to simplify the delivery. All of this perhaps is driven through a very important aspect, which is collecting the monitorings and taking a decision based on those monitoring systems. So we'll speak a bit about the end-to-end service monitoring of NFV. And this is a kind of a model that we are starting to think that this might work. So we have a service request. This could be a service chain in itself, but it could be a collection of services which define an overall service. And we would like to transform this service to resource requests. Why do we need to do that? Because each service request would carry its own KPIs. And those KPIs might be quite abstract in nature, that I need to have, I need my service deliveries in a certain time frame. Now, how does that really matter, or how does that really impact the resources which are getting hosted on cloud? So we need to transform those KPIs into certain requirements for the resources which are going to be deployed on the cloud. For example, we have to translate that to the number of CPUs, virtual CPUs, what kind of memory we need, what kind of networking capacity we need, do we need rate limiting, do we need to guarantee bandwidth. So based on the service requirement, we need to transform them to certain resource requests, and therefore the KPI also gets translated to a KPI which is more relevant to the resource request. Once those resource requests are made, we need to deploy them, of course. And then we start to monitor them, because we need to dynamically decide whether our KPIs are getting met or not, and if they are not, then what actions we need to take. So we need to, of course, generate those monitoring, we need to collect them, we need to aggregate them, and then we need to analyze them. Most probably, we need to even visualize them in some way or other. And then based on our analysis, we need to take some actions on those specific monitorings that we are capturing. Now take a very simple example that we have here. We have a firewall, a load balancer, switch, hypervisors, some network functions, and they are all different elements, and some of them could be open source, some of them could be vendor delivered. All of them have completely different ways of managing themselves. Also, there might be completely different ways of generating logs from them, from the generating monitorings from them. And we, however, need to understand that if we have to take decisions on the health of this system or the health of this service, then we need to have an instantaneous way of collecting logs, collecting monitorings, and taking action on them. So apart from that, the complexity could also be that the clouds are interconnected over VPN, and then there could be SDN controllers who are not part of the, as such, the virtual infrastructure manager. It is a controller which is defining the different service chain, the traffic steering, and the traffic limiting, and how to actually ensure that even that performance of that particular controller is also taken into account while taking decisions of on scaling, elasticity, and resource optimization. So most probably, we have to think of a unified model for NFV. This might be a little disruptive in nature because we do not have one now. So can we have a uniform way of collecting monitorings? Can we have a uniform way, a protocol of collecting monitorings, which nearly every vendor can follow, or the open source components can follow? Then perhaps we can come to a situation where we can unify the monitoring collection and then actually using it to take decisions, and particularly taking decisions for orchestration. This is also needed by the OSS as well. So the standardization perhaps needs to be done right up to the OSS. So the current OSS may not understand everything that gets generated from the cloud. For example, the legacy OSS may not know what is a VM death, and why do we need a VM death? How a VM death is going to impact the overall services? So there must be a way to escalate issues right up to the OSS. And then, if needed, we take actions right from the virtual infrastructure manager, that's OpenStack, and right up to the orchestrator. So there must be a way where we are able to take decisions uniformly. We are able to escalate issues uniformly onto the higher layer. And in order to have this uniformity, we might need to collect things in an uniform way. So another example that we might want to look at is, suppose we have an example service chain where the traffic is getting steered from A, B, C, and D. And so this is sort of a traffic path. And then for some reason, we need to scale up B. So we use a load balancer or some ways to scale up B. And the traffic starts getting steered through this, or the new traffic starts getting steered through this scaled node. Of course, it will not just work like that. We need to perhaps modify or reconfigure A and C as well. And once this new node is in action and the traffic starts getting steered, we might also come to a situation when the subsequent subgraph gets overloaded. So the decision making may not just be for that particular node. So when you take a decision for a node, you also need to take the decision of the subsequent nodes. And we face this problem quite frequently. So we cannot take decisions of a service in isolation. So if one component we want to take a decision, we have to consider what is the impact of the entire chain. For example, there could be a decision that we take that instead of scaling just that node, we scale the entire subgraph of that node. And in that way, we can perhaps limit the modifications that are required on the either side of the scaled node. However, this model has a pitfall that it is creating scaled nodes for C and D as well. So there could be some wastage of resources. We might be unnecessarily creating virtual machines hosting C and D, which may not have been required. So in either case, there would be a situation when we need to take a decision whether to use a load balancer, whether to scale the entire graph, whether to scale one of the nodes. So we need to take those decisions. And as you can see, the decisions cannot be taken in isolation. Therefore, we need a way to instantaneously decide what is the situation of the entire graph at that point of time. So orchestrators' devices who takes this decision on scaling has to take the impact of the entire service. Going forward, I'll just check whether I'm running out of time. Well, okay. So going forward, let's also take a situation where there is a need to have different kind of monitoring for different kind of states. Say, for example, a VNF has certain states like install, start, stop, monitor, maintain, run. So there are different states of a certain VNF. And for example, in this case, we have A, B, C, D, and all of them are running, so they have a certain state. All of them are in run state. And then we can derive a chain state based on the application and its corresponding state. So say we call that chain state, say, as CH1. Now, what we will monitor, what kind of monitoring we will start for the entire chain depends on the state. So when the element is running, we would be picking up certain statistics. When the element is not running, where maybe when it is in a maintenance mode, one of the elements is in maintenance mode, or there is a load balancing situation, one is getting scaled up. There could be multiple situations where the state of the chain changes. What you require to monitor now at this situation when everything is running and what you need to monitor when one of them is in a different state would be different. So we need to have a state-aware monitoring system because of the simple reason. For example, if B is being, say, under upgrade, so we would be focusing on a complete set of different parameters while B is under upgrade, whether the upgrade is successful, whether we need to do a rollback, whether we need to do something else with if the upgrade doesn't succeed. So a completely different set of monitoring, so a different set of statistics are required at this state compared to when everything is running. We might have a completely different set of statistics that we need to take. So the state of the chain also changes. The state of the monitoring also changes. So eventually, we would have to make a model which not just takes into account the entire chain's health. We also need to take into account the individual state of those elements and then aggregate them to decide what monitoring we start, what monitoring we collect, and how do we aggregate those monitoring and then take a decision based on that. Now coming to, if you recall one of my earlier slides, I said there was a transformation function which is transforming a service request to resource requests. Say for example, let's take this case where there is a chain, a somewhat hypothetical example, but it helps. So the traffic, there are two kinds of traffic, one A, B, C, D, and one will be A, B, C, E, F. And there would be different KPIs at different interfaces. For example, there could be a KPI between A and B. There could be a KPI for the entire delivery of service from A to D or from A to F. So there would be multiple KPIs in a single service request. Now what we tried to infer from our earlier thesis is that we have to convert this service request into multiple resource requests. So what could be those resource requests? So these could be computing resource requests. So in order to ensure this kind of a KPI, we might have to convert them into resource requests, like what could be the CPU, what could be the memory. So there could be computing resource requests, there could be networking resource requests, if there's a need for guaranteed bandwidth. Or there could be placement requests, so there's a certain element may require a node which has SRIOV or PCI pass-through enabled, or it needs a certain hardware accelerator. It's quite common in NFV situation. So there could be a requirement on, there could be a placement request. And also the placement request could depend on the constraints that we have of that particular infrastructure. But at the end of it, we need to ensure that the KPIs are met. So we have to transform the request in such a way that we are translating the service request to the resource request. For example, this eventually turns out to be something like this, where there is a certain traffic flow, so we know a certain steering has to be done, so there is a networking configuration which SDN controller does. Or say the A to F traffic flow is differently done. So we have now a service request, we have a collection of resource requests. So how does this model actually then works? So we have a service orchestrator, so this is just an example, and a controller. We have infrastructure managers, we have other networking devices. We get a service request which is characterized by the KPIs. From the service request, we do the resource decomposition, and then, for example, we create the network chaining request, so sort of networking request, which the SDN controller then configures the networking services or sets up the traffic steering. Then there would be a set of computing requests. There could be a set of placement requests. and which the service orchestrator is actually decomposing this and then configuring individual controllers. And these individual controllers are then configuring the infrastructure. So the placement request could lead to resource requests, some placement requests, some resource reservations. So for example, in NFV, we just cannot believe in resource allocation at runtime as best effort. We have to do some kind of resource reservations. Otherwise, we might not be able to guarantee the service. So those decisions have to be taken. So those decisions also have to be driven from the KPI itself. Then perhaps we start instantiating the virtual network functions one by one in the chain. So we will instantiate the resource, the VNF will get created, the VNF would get configured. So eventually the entire service would get deployed. And then we start monitoring them. So when we say monitoring them, there could be multiple points in the resource decomposition model where we need to monitor. For example, we might need to monitor at the time the resource requests are getting deployed. Or we have to monitor how the resource decomposition has been done, because we need to link back the monitoring when we take it back to the service orchestrator. From the monitoring right up to the service adherence, we have to first break it and then join it. Yeah, so this is the model that we tried to create. This is a simplified model. Life will not be so simple eventually. There would be lot more complexities involved. There will be lot more resource creations, lot more resource decompositions, but this is just a simplified model to just understand whether this will actually work or not. But one important thing is that how to actually monitor the end-to-end services. Now we have decomposed it. So we had the service request, we decomposed it, we have deployed it. Now how to monitor it. So say again, we take a simple example. So the infrastructure monitor can monitor the different compute nodes, the networking nodes. So basically, for example, Cilometer or any other telemetry methods can monitor the infrastructure as such. But how to monitor the elements which are running inside the virtual machines? So most probably we need something there. So we have to think of a service-aware monitor which not just considers the network elements which are hosted, but also considers the state of the network elements. And those network elements then have to be planned throughout the service monitoring method. And the service monitoring would be defined on the service templates, what kind of service level agreements we have done, and the model that we have decided. The question is, do we need to standardize these containers, which will contain the monitoring data, the statistics which are getting generated by the application? Do we need to do that? I would say that it's quite debatable. But most probably, if we have to have an efficient way of monitoring and delivering services on an NFV, we perhaps need to think in those directions. So we created a simplified architecture for our proof of concept. So we had we used the standard OpenStack monitoring methods like Cilometer for storage, compute, and networking. For the different network functions that we hosted, we had access to those network functions. So we created agents which can generate monitoring based on a certain protocol that we decided. The protocol is actually stacking the monitoring. So say, for example, if the traffic goes from A, B, C, then we stack the monitoring C, B, A. So this is just the monitorings are on one top of another in the direction the traffic is getting steered, and then we store it in a database, and then we have a monitoring initiator and an aggregator, which is part of the controller system, which initiates the monitoring based on what is the state of the monitoring system. If there is a certain action that is being taken on the VNF, then it also considers that. And then the service orchestrator, based on those parameters, can take a decision on what actions it should take in terms of scaling, whether it needs to reconfigure the resources, whether it needs to initiate some kind of service healing, or it needs to look at the different alarms that get generated. While doing this, we also realized that we can push some of these functions downwards towards OpenStack. So the earliest we can take a self-healing option, the better. So it could well turn out to be, when we are done with this, that we eventually figure some of these elements are actually pushed down towards OpenStack, towards the virtual infrastructure manager, and bring it as close as possible to the network function. Okay, so we did a simulation of this model. So here in this simulation, we took service request of which consisted about some switches, some routers, some firewalls, some load balancers, some data generating VNFs. And then then our model converted those service requests into resource requests. We implemented service aware placement, which is basically a linear programming with latency routing and the switching capacity as the key constraints. We also used VNF states to start and stop monitoring or modify monitoring. We used two states in this simulation, install and run. And we did the service aware monitoring, and this date and this timeline or what results that is visible is actually from the start or the receiving of the service request and when the service first service monitoring gets collected and aggregated and when it reaches the orchestrator. Roughly it turned out to be linear. Of course we need to further dig deep into it. The decision making, or rather currently the time of the evaluation time for adding service requests to this model is dominated by the service placement, because it's a linear programming which solves the problem, the constraint problem. But we feel that as it becomes larger and larger and there are more and more service requests getting added, this could eventually the optimization needs to be done at the decomposition and aggregation part. So in future we would work more on this and try and see if this model eventually gives us some kind of an information on how to improve the model's decomposition and aggregation part. Okay, so we'll now conclude in terms of what are the key conclusions from this project. Is that we were able to decompose service request to resource request in a structured manner. We had a VNF state aware monitoring model where we could aggregate data. Perhaps we need standardization of monitoring models where all NFV or VNF vendors come together, or the open source community comes together and starts deciding on what would be a standard way of collecting and exposing monitoring information, for example statistics. We also know that there is a need to have a service aware placement. I did not cover part of this, but of course the service aware placement is a linear programming model. Because lack of time, I did not cover that, but yes, the service aware placement is also very much a part of the overall orchestration model. And also we realized that there needs to be a modularity in the architecture, in the sense that if a new type of service request gets added, then it should not disturb the existing service request. So we should be able to add new service requests quite seamlessly. Okay. So now we'll come to another use case, which is not exactly related to what we just discussed, but this is something we did very recently, so I wanted to share the results. So it's a Cloud RAN use case, and Cloud RAN is actually a mobile broadband solution for LTE, where the base station has a layer one, and the base station has the baseband pooling or the baseband processing is done at the locations where the antennas are, and the remaining part of the eNodeB software is actually hosted on cloud. In this case, you can see in the proof of concept that we did, we used a host real-time Linux, and we used the KVM hypervisors. There were you can see there are two eNodeBs. In each eNodeB, the software functionality was divided into two virtual machines. One containing the L2 part, the protocols like MAC, RLC, and PDCP, and then in the other virtual machine, we hosted the L3 part, so basically the layer 3 telecom part, the radio resource management, and the OAM part. So this was the overall system view of the things, and we used OpenStack Juno to realize this. And so you can see this from this diagram, that the eNodeB one and there is an eNodeB two, both are hosted on different compute nodes, they are on separate, they are communicating over external IPs and not internal IPs, or private IPs, I mean to say. The virtual EPC, which is the S1 interface of the Cloud Run solution, is also hosted on the compute node. The antenna site, the layer one, is separate. It's on the public network. Of course, it was this entire proof of concept was done within a lab, so it is as public as it can be. And then we created the different interfaces. We abstracted the internal the private IPs with the external IPs. And we had some very good results, in fact. So we realized that we could reach an uplink throughput of 60 Mbps quite easily. And we had a downlink throughput of 120 Mbps. More importantly, the CPU load was increasing linearly as we moved to higher throughput. So that meant that in the virtual machine system, even when in LTE we have a very small TTI, which is 1 millisecond, the transmission time interval, so the scheduling is quite fast. So in each TTI, a lot of UEs get scheduled. And in spite of that, the CPU usage was fairly linear, and we did not find any bottleneck as such when we just monitored the throughput. We got into some issues when we added more and more mobile stations, but then those are mainly because of the fact that the real-time scheduling of the UEs in a one particular maxed slot was getting was overloading the system. And each virtual machine was a simple one CPU, 2 GB memory, so it can actually, you can make larger ones and improve the efficiency as well. But the more important thing is that this proof of concept was possible, and we could see a very distinct trend of how the CPU was performing. Some of the key observations. So the key observation with Cloud RAN was that there was a lot of packet buffering and loss in the initial stages, primarily because it had a 1 millisecond transmission time, and we solved that through by enabling PCI pass-through. The other problem was to get live VM migration work for that particular VM where the MAC is located. For example, if I just go back, so this particular VM where the layer 2 is located. So doing a live VM migration of that particular virtual machine was quite challenging, because